Welcome everybody to Trinity Talks, The Road Less Travelled. My name is Dorothy Meyer-Holtkamp, producer and outreach coordinator with Near FM. I'd like to welcome our audience here in Trinity Longroom Hall and also our audience on Facebook. This is the final programme in our series, which is particularly close to my heart, having returned to education in a roundabout way myself. Over the course of these conversations, we have met current and past students from Trinity College Dublin who have taken the road less travelled to education. And today's guest has a unique story to tell. We are delighted to welcome Mark McMahon, whose educational journey took him from his local community school in Blanchardstown to the Pathway to Law programme organised by Trinity's Access Programme, TAP, and on to a degree in Law and Business at Trinity College Dublin. Mark will be in conversation with Sarah Grimson, the Foundation Course Coordinator with the Trinity Access Programme. At the end of the conversation, there will be an opportunity to ask questions or make a comment. For our audience joining us on Facebook, we'd be delighted if you could pop your comment or question into the chat and we'll read it out at the end. And anybody in the audience, please wait until one of us gets to you so that you can speak into the microphone. Please keep your mask on during this conversation. That's all from me, and I'll pass over to Sarah.
Thank you very much, Dorothy. I think this is one of my favourite parts of my job, when I get to meet students. So you came in the course with us in TAP in 2015, Mark, and it's so lovely to see you thriving and making your community and your profession more inclusive and richer and a better place. So I've loved sitting here with you for the last half hour, gossiping about what everyone else is up to and all the success stories. Could you tell us a little bit about your childhood, your family?
So I think I've had a fairly normal childhood from what I can see. Anyway, you know, grew up with my mum and dad and two brothers in the middle. So I had an older brother who was 2 years older than me and a younger brother who was 15 months younger than me, so not a lot between us. Normal child, out on the road, playing football, getting up to what normal kids do. Attended local school, local community school, Blakestown Community School. Same school my mum would have went when she was a kid. She's from the area, Blanchardstown. You know, I would have had teachers and principals who also taught my mum. So, fairly normal childhood. So I started that school in 2010. And then went right up to my leaving cert in 2015. And, I loved football. Obviously, didn't make the grade as a footballer, but sure. Isn't that the story of most of us?
You'd be a top barrister instead.
Yeah, hopefully, anyway.
I have three boys at home, so I feel your mum's pain.
yeah. My mum was. I think she always wanted a girl, but
it's all defeating.
Yeah.
Was there a family tradition of going to college?
No. So I come from normal background, more of a working class background. Would probably be described. My dad drives a taxi and my mum works in childcare. Mm-hmm. None of them went to college. No one from the extended family ever went to college. So there's no real tradition. But I did enjoy school, so I always thought that college was an option for me. I never thought that was completely exclusion or impossible to get there. I didn't see anyone though who I could relate to who'd been there. But my guidance counselor and teachers in the school were always very good to me and always really encouraged me that college was always an option for me.
Okay, so when you were in fifth year, was it you were introduced to Trinity Access Programme, Pathways to Law Programme?
Yeah, so when I was in fifth year, which would have been probably around 2013, 2014, my guidance counsellor, Miss Kinsella, was on her. She was very good to me. She always kept in touch with all the outreach programmes at the universities, particularly the Access Programme. And she, for some reason, in her head, she thought of me when she stumbled across the Pathways to Law Programme, which TAP did, and introduced me to it. And for people who didn't know what it was, I could probably best describe it as the outreach programme that the Access Programme did through Trinity, which kind of went to young people and students who probably didn't have a traditional route into third level education or any traditional route to a career in law, and try to encourage those young people to consider a career in law or even studying law at third level university. And they did this through very informal activities and games. So they used to get us in every couple of evenings a month after school in either the Law Society or in Trinity here somewhere, and we'd do fun activities like the O.J. Simpson case, so we'd all pretend we were barristers and we'd get the facts of the O.J. Simpson case, the famous O.J. Simpson case, and we'd all prepare our statements and we'd pretend to examine witnesses and we do our closing speeches, and then there would be a judge who would rule on the side of the state or rule not guilty. So good activity, it really got me interested in law. And then probably from that moment onwards, I probably realised that studying law was something I'd like to do. You know, I never considered it beforehand, and I always thought I'd like a solid job that would give me a guaranteed income, like an accountant or something. You know, something very typical of a working class background, somebody who thinks, okay, I need to get a job that's always going to be available and will always pay the bills. So yeah, I went from that then into my Leaving Cert. I was happy enough with my Leaving Cert. When the CEO came around, I got offered law through something called the feasibility study. I'm not sure if it's still around now. But I got offered a place directly at the law in here in Trinity, and I was over the moon. But actually, the foundation course was the first thing I wanted to do. Lucky enough, I got offered this place like that. So I did the foundation course, which basically meant was I took a year before studying law, where I could have went straight into law. Mm-hmm. I think that was, looking back now, it was a smart decision.
So that's when we would have first met, yeah, in 2015, when you came into Trinity.
Definitely,
and studied, yeah, with us. So there was only 25 people in the class, very small group on the foundation course. How did you find that?
I think I was in my element at the time. You know, I really had a great fun that year. You know, around people who I could relate to, you know, people from similar backgrounds to myself, with similar ambitions to myself as well, wanting to better themselves, wanting to get educated, make a career, or do whatever they wanted. I really enjoyed the year, you know, being in kind of like a small, kind of like a cult is probably the wrong word to describe, but kind of small group where you realise that you're all in this together and you all have near enough same goals and can support each other while doing that. So yeah, that was great. On the foundation course, I studied like subjects like, I think I did politics and maths and history. Like, there was a broad range of subjects. So even though I kind of knew I'd like to study law, I had to supplement studying law on the foundation course with other subjects. And that was really interesting, because I did really love history. And like, seeing history from a university point of view was completely different to history from a secondary school point of view. And I was very quickly then ruled out that I probably would never like to be a historian, which is fine, but I would never have made that decision without the foundation course. And I could easily see myself pursuing a degree and falling out of love with it very quickly if it wasn't for the foundation course, you know. And I think that's a problem with a lot of young people, when they're going straight from Leaving Cert into degrees, and then realising after one semester that they don't actually want to be an accountant or don't want to be an historian or whatever it is. And in many ways they're trapped, you know. And I was lucky enough to avoid feeling that.
So having that year to try things out, to really, really firm up your decision to do law, yeah, was helpful.
Yeah, I don't think I'd be here today without it. I think it really should be mandatory. If I was to do it all again, or if I was to become Minister of Education, I'd reform the whole thing and make everyone do a more or less a foundation year before they went into their degree. Because we all think we know what we like until we're actually in it, you know. Unfortunately, the way the system's organised and just setting barriers around funding and fees and stuff, it can be, particularly for people who are on maybe funding from SUSE, it can be very difficult then to say, I want to switch courses. Which really, at 18 years old, nobody should be in a position to decide what you want to do for the rest of their life. And someone always said to me, like, you do your Leaving Cert when you're 17 or 18, and the week before your Leaving Cert, when you're in class, you have to put up your hand and ask the teacher permission to go to the toilet. But then the following week or the following few months, your CEO comes in, you have to decide what you want to do for the rest of your life, more or less, you know. Now, and obviously a degree doesn't determine your entire life, but it is a big commitment. It's for 3 or 4 years, so I think the system really needs to be overhauled. And an exception in the system, like I did the foundation course, really, really helped me. It really, in my mind, satisfied me that a career in law was for me.
So what did your parents think when you came, and your brothers think when you came to Trinity?
Yeah, well, my brothers always thought that I was just floating around Trinity, you know, floating around just having a crack, which I did a lot of the time, but my brothers never actually considered the thought I was actually doing serious work, which is, you know, it's a bit of back and forth between me and my brothers, you know. They would have had jobs, you know, like manual jobs, so they would consider themselves hard working. Where I was coming in with a few books saying, oh, I did a whole lot of 2 hours class today, you know. But that was always a bit of back and forth with my brothers. Parents were very proud of me, always supported me, you know, never put me under any pressure to start contributing in terms of finances, or never, always helped me anytime I needed help financially, or even just basic support, like somewhere to study or noise in the house. You know, I always felt support from my family, and again, I still wouldn't be here if it wasn't for them, you know.
Did you feel pressure from your family, being the first in the family, like pressure to succeed?
No, not pressure to succeed, more pressure to, actually, pressure not to mess up, so you could call it pressure to succeed. You know, when I started studying law, I started really considering down what I'd like to do afterwards, you know. And then there's many careers available for somebody with a law degree, but a lot of people think it'll come down to, do you want to be a solicitor or a barrister? Mm. And if you compare those two roles, a solicitor, in many ways, is a lot more secure job. It's a lot more guaranteed income. And I never once felt pressured to take that option, you know, to take a more secure role with more or less guaranteed income and more security. You know, I never felt that pressure from my parents to choose that option. That's something which I really appreciate. Mm.
So that unconditional support to unconditional play with your own
support,
path.
Yeah. Yeah, unconditional support, and because even though, like I said, my parents never went to full level education, I consider both of them still very clever people, mm-hmm. you know, and they'd always, even with basic decisions, career decisions, life decisions, I'd still always ask for their advice, you know, and I really value their opinion, you know, still very clever people.
There's no age limit on education, you can come on the foundation course for mature students.
Yeah, I should say it to them, shouldn't I?
Yeah, why not? Do many of your schoolmates come here?
No, I don't think anyone from my school, from my year group anyway, came into Trinity, and more or less reflective on the area which I grew up in, you know, a lot of people in the school wouldn't probably have seen tour level education as an option for them, which is a real shame, because I never considered myself any special or any smarter than anyone else, you know. I landed on my feet in many ways, you know, I applied for certain things, I got them, I got support along the way. And I look back and I see people who are just as clever, if not more clever than me, even maybe more hardworking than me. They never consider college as an option. And that's not just their fault, that's really how the system really portrays it, how you need a certain amount of points, and if you don't get these certain amount of points, you'll never be an accountant or a vet, whatever you want to do. You know, there is other ways around that, and I think going those other ways, accessing into certain careers or courses, really help people to realise that there is options for them, you know, mm-hmm. and just because the leave side doesn't go great, it isn't the end of the world, you know. And that goes back to what I was saying earlier, all this pressure is pumped on the leave side, how you all of a sudden expected to decide what you want for the rest of your life, which I don't have no knowledge backing up, but I don't think in other countries that is the case. I think we have in this country, and I think we've seen it recently enough in the news, we have a deep obsession with the leaving state in this country, even when you're 30, 40 years of age. We love talking about it. You know, even you could be at a party and you're asking someone, what did you get on your leaving state? Or did you do honours maths? You know? And I don't think that's the case in any other country. Well, maybe I'm wrong, but you know, I think people from Northern Ireland as well have also expressed this. People from the north of Ireland living down there express our obsession with the leaving state. And then that falls into all the other things. You know, it can reflect into people not knowing what to do because of the pressure on the leave to. So, like I said, if I was in control, I'd reform the whole thing, but maybe sometime in the future.
I wouldn't doubt you. You go on, who knows what you'll do next. So when you came in and did your degree in law and business after the foundation course, were the people like you in the class?
Yeah, there was. When I went into my degree, law is fairly big in Trinity. Law and business can be quite small, which was my degree when I finished the foundation course. The law itself is quite big. A lot of people from different backgrounds, but there is a large background present, and it wouldn't be a background that I associate with. It would be a background from people who probably private school educated through secondary school and didn't need a foundation course or whatever to get into the course they wanted. Now, that wasn't a problem for me. Like, I still have many friends, which I consider lifelong friends for the future, who are from different backgrounds from me that would have not been from working class backgrounds. But it can be difficult for somebody, particularly in law. I think law is an area which has a lot of traditions, a lot of stereotypes of certain people go into law and certain people will succeed at law. So I think that does attract a lot more people from more privileged backgrounds than others. But one thing which I always said about kind of working class people or access students at Trinity, that they always find each other, you know, in the groups, you know. So I always did find people with law and law business that I could relate to. and enjoy being in our company. And like I said, even people who I couldn't relate with socially or didn't have the same background, I always did enjoy being in our company, you know. But no, it wasn't easy to make friends, so to speak, in law. And I have no problem saying that.
What do you think could be done to change that, to make it better?
I think more programmes like the foundation course, more support for people going into education from underprivileged or underrepresented backgrounds into a level of education. I think, without going on a rant, I think there's a lot of barriers to education. I think we could scrap student contributions and the likes and make it completely free. And that would also help lots of social and cultural barriers. But I think law in Trinity, or maybe law in other universities, is a reflection really of a lot of inequalities that I think we have in Ireland, you know. I think people from certain backgrounds are underrepresented in many areas of the law. Look at the Dáil or any other above decision-making authority, I think it's hard to get diversity. Mm. And I think it's something Ireland's coming better at, but I think a lot can be done, you know. And I don't really probably have the best answers to do that. So I can just see it though.
Do you think you'll be a bit of a trailblazer?
Yes and no. If I could be a trailblazer for anything, I'd like to be a trailblazer for people to apply for everything, you know, realise the supports around them, realising the opportunities that they can have. You know, I wouldn't consider myself a trailblazer of consistent hard work, consistent, unbelievable intelligence, you know, because when I was in college, there was a lot of people that spoke to me and I admired. I remember speaking with people in Trinity and before class, medicine students in particular, and before class they would wake up at 4 a.m. or go to an office at 4 a.m. to clean, because that was their part-time job, was to clean the offices, and they needed that money to survive. And I was very lucky that I did have part-time jobs during college, but I never had to wake up at 4 a.m. for my class to clean the offices, get a part-time job just to make ends meet, pay my rent. You know, my parents are from Dublin, I live in Dublin, I still live with my parents, I don't pay rent. That's very lucky, you know? And so I don't consider myself a trailblazer for an amazing story of success. If I could be remembered for anything, or if people wanted to look at me, I would like to look at me to think that I applied for a foundation course because I thought sports would have been better for me at the time, you know? Like, with the Pathways Law Programme, they continued to support me right up and through my degree. And then after my degree, I decided I wanted to be a barrister. I was very lucky to get increased support from that, from the Denham Fellowship. So if I wanted anyone to learn anything, it would be like, it's important to work hard and know what you want, but also just take advantage of what's available to you, you know? And there's nothing wrong with taking advantage of that, you know? There's nothing to be guilty of, you know? At the end of the day, I consider myself a competent barrister just as much as anyone else, you know? The difference is I didn't have to pay King's Inns fees, you know?
So seize every opportunity.
Exactly, yeah.
I remember you from your time in Trinity as a very, very committed ambassador for the Trinity Access Programmes. So, you know, we rely on volunteers, like, you know, ambassadors to help us run events, to go out and inspire others, to mentor younger students. Why did you do that?
I think it's just about giving back. I think, you know, I remember when I was in school, there was people who would come to my school and they would tell us about what's it like studying at Trinity. And to be honest, they tell us all the fun things about what it was like studying at Trinity. And I always appreciated that, because I always thought when I was a kid, college is a great opportunity to further and better yourself. It's also a great opportunity to have fun. I think a lot of people from world-class areas don't realise that. So any time to get an opportunity involved and give something back, I'd always take that opportunity. And when I did do a walk with TAP as an ambassador, I'd always try to show kids or students the fun things about college, you know, because a lot of the time, I'd also mention all the access supports, but a lot of the time, they already knew that, you know, and I think for some people, showing the social side of college, showing that, like, it's not exactly like school, you're not going to be in class from 9 o'clock to 4 o'clock, you know, I think that side of it was important to show kids. And for some kids, I think that would have made them realise that, actually, no, I'd like to go to college, because it's not just all about the books, you know, it is a bit of crack involved. And I always did enjoy doing that work with the ambassador and stuff. Again, I met some friends which I never met in Trinity, which I consider now lifelong friends from that ambassador, you know. So yeah, it was all part of the journey, and no regrets.
Yeah, I really agree with you, Mark, that fun side of college, the developing a community, having social activities, trying out new things is so important. And I feel for the students over the last year or two, because I think it's been harder to do that.
Yeah, definitely. Like, when I went in the first year of my degree, I joined the Geography Society. I had no interest in geography whatsoever. I didn't even do geography for my leaving cert. And the reason why is because they told me they were going to Romania in semester one, and it was going to cost me €100 all in, you know? And that was our salt, you know? And a year three, I was treasurer of the Geography Society. Everyone in the Geography Society are geography students, you know? And then anyone would come up and ask me, and they say, oh, what do you do? I said, oh, I study law and business, you know? But I'm the treasurer of the Geography Society, you know? And
did you go on the trip?
I went on the trip, and I even organised our own trip for that. I brought 40 geography students to Bulgaria in my third year of my degree, Sofia in Bulgaria, which it's not easy organising 40 anyone, not particularly geography students, to get to Sofia in Bulgaria. Mm-hmm. But I like to say that story is because I never would have went into college planning that, you know? And those sort of stories, it's really what college is all about. Mm-hmm. Keeps people from my background encouraged, motivated to get to college, to experience these moments. And again, I've met people now, geography students, which are lifelong friends because of my involvement in the Geography Society. So if any law and business or any law students are watching this, get involved in the Geography Society. That's good crack.
And you stayed involved in the Pathways to Law programme right the way through your degree. So what did that involve? You spoke to us before about in school, what it entailed.
Yeah, so once I started my degree, Pathways Law was still very good to me. A lot more mature things that probably go through a lot of the mind of law students that they would try to help out with. So for example, a lot of law students would think about how they're going to get a job after the degree, how they're going to get an internship during the summer of the law degree. And they'd always organise workshops for us to maybe send in our CVs, do CV workshops, how to build up our CVs. I remember one year I was thinking of applying for an internship in a big law firm, and the Pathways Law Programme organised a buddy system, so I got paired with a mentor who was already a solicitor in this law firm, and they went through my application with me, and they gave me points and hints exactly how to improve my application. That was great help. You know, a lot of law students are really, particularly people from my own background, really express about doing these interviews and getting into these good jobs. They also organise guest speakers. Like, so I remember one night they had Mary Robinson in, which I was really impressed by. She gave us a talk, and she was a really impressive person, which I suppose most people realise, but she also had a similar background to many people from Pathways Law Programme. You know, she was a real trailblazer for female barristers at the bar. And a lot of people, including myself, could relate to that, you know. And those stories, I don't really know many people who got those types of talks from Mary Robinson. Those stories, which I really think helped me through my degree, and I'm very thankful to Pathways Law and Tab for helping me with them, you know.
The kind of meeting inspirational people, but then also having the really practical supports of this is your CV, this is your application,
exactly,
both sides. So how did you get to become a barrister? How did you make that happen?
Yeah, so like I said, I was very lucky again. I landed on my feet again. I think about towards your fourth year of my degree, I decided I'd like to be a barrister. Lots of different boring reasons why I'd like that. Mainly because it's self-employed, so you don't have a boss. A little bit of a problem with authority, working on it at the moment. But so that was a big pull for me. And I did like law, you know, a bit of a law nerd, so that always helped. So if anyone's thinking about being a barrister, it's not the most successful career. There's a lot of barriers, particularly, and most importantly, it might be financial barriers. So the King's Inns is the only school in the country to qualify as a barrister. I think their barrister law degree course is around €12,500. It's money I didn't have coming towards the end of my degree. So realistically, if I wanted to be a barrister, I would have to, after my degree, get a job somewhere. Probably in a law firm, or somebody would help me on my degree, work for a couple of years and save up as much money as possible to pay for the King's Inns and support me. And then after King's Inns, you qualified as a barrister, and then for a year / 2 years you devil, which is like an intern year, or how do they describe it again in England? A pupillage year. So that's also very little income, very little of your own work, you know, so it is a very financial burden. and I was conscious of that. And somebody from TAP, Owen O'Connor, who's a great man himself, he pointed me in the direction of the Denham Fellowship, which is a fellowship named after the former Chief Justice Susan Denham. And it was a fellowship where two people in Ireland could apply, and these people had to be from access backgrounds similar enough to myself, and they could apply, and if they were successful, they would get a certain amount of support, such as financial support, social support, cultural support. And I was very lucky. I did apply for that. I did the interview, a very terrible interview. I was lucky enough to get that. And I remember the interview. The interview was interviewed by like seven people around the table. It was very daunting, you know. And I was lucky enough to get that. I'm happy that they seen something in me. And so that meant that I was able to go straight from my degree into King's Inns. I still had to do entrance exams to get into King's Inns. Once I got past them, I was lucky enough to get King's Inns fees paid for me. Now I'm in my first year of my practice as a barrister, and I'm lucky enough that the fellowship will pay my law library fees for the first few years of practice. It's also a very significant financial burden. So I'm very lucky in that sense to be a barrister. I wouldn't be a barrister right now if it wasn't for the Denham Fellowship. And again, there's people who I met during my law degree who wanted to be barristers, who are smart enough to be barristers, who probably would be better barristers than me. The only difference is a lot of those people are probably working right now to save to be a barrister, and I'm very lucky that I'm not in that position.
It's just interesting, Mark, because you keep using the word lucky.
Yeah, I'm very lucky, aren't I?
I think I think you've made the luck happen, because right away from school, it sounds like every time there was an opportunity to apply for something, whether it be Pathways to Law or the Geography Society, you've seized all those opportunities and put time and effort into making them work.
In many ways, you make your own luck. But the message I get across is that, like, keep the eyes and ears open, apply for everything, and keep going. You know, that's, you know, I'm no like beacon to say that. Like, maybe my story would have been more impressive if I was 30 years old and I went down to the bar after working for 10 years, save up that money. Because in many ways, that would probably show that I had the drive. Now, I was definitely prepared to do that. You know. Well, in many ways, I have a lot more admiration for somebody who had the drive and had to work for it. Or not had to work, or knew that they wanted it really bad because they put their money where their mouth is, you know. And Denham Fellowship didn't just help me with money. It helped me a lot with mentors. So the career at the bar, it's not just about the money. There's a social side to it. All barristers are self-employed. It can be very difficult to get your own work in. And it's very socially, some people would describe it as a closed shop area to walk in. And the fellowship really helped me in kind of closing down those barriers, but provided me mentors, so experienced barristers, even a judge who met with me, gave me pointers, who would always have the opportunity to meet with. If anyone had a question about a problem with anything, I could always ask these mentors I had, which is, again, is extremely valuable. You probably couldn't put a value on that. You know, because there's a lot of things day to day which, as a junior barrister, you have questions that are very basic questions, and it's always good to be able to have these people to lean on, which other people might not have. So that's also very valuable to me.
So there's someone to lean on, they're making the hidden things explicit, helping you with networking.
Exactly, yeah.
Why do you think they do it?
I think they do it because a lot of them were probably, you think back to when they were starting off as a barrister, they would see the barriers, the hurdles around building up contacts, paying bills, or getting work in. And I think they think back and think, that was terrible. And if only I could have someone that would point me in the direction. And they're seeing an opportunity to get involved and help point junior barristers in the direction. So I assume that's how they get involved. They've all been very nice to me. Everyone's been very nice to me. That's one thing which I'll add about the bar, is that although it's not the most successful place to get to, I've never felt undermined, disrespected so far working as a barrister. You know, I'm still very short in my tenure, but I talked earlier about realising that people was a little bit different while studying law in Trinity. And I do realise that people have different backgrounds at the bar, but I've never felt undermined, disrespected whatsoever, which is very rewarding, you know. So my message would be, very hard to get there, but once you get there, you're treated like an equal. You know?
Yeah, it's inclusive when you're there.
Yeah, I think so.
What kind of law are you specialising in?
So right now, I'm dabbling in crime. So criminal law, yeah. And next year I'm hoping to get a bit more experience in asylum immigration. Okay. So anything that's public law I'm interested in. So for people that really know, that's basically when the state's involved. Anything that the state's involved on one side is more or less public law, you know.
And which side are you on in criminal law?
I do mainly defence work at the moment, but the thing is at the bar, it's all about independence, you know. Barristers could be working for the state one time and then the next day working against the state. So there's a lot of barristers down there that practice would be 50-50. 50-50 between prosecution work mm-hmm. and defence work, you know. So it's interesting like that as well, you know.
Was it very hard because you would have just been starting out as a barrister as COVID hit and the courts were closed?
Yeah.
How did you manage that?
Well, I was lucky enough, my King's Inns year was all online, so I was able to do that through Zoom. And so that wasn't too bad. I finished Trinity as well through Zoom. So by the time I finished King's Inns through Zoom, I was all Zoomed out, which I think most people probably yep. are at the moment. And then when I started, the courts, actually criminal courts were reopening, you know. So I didn't actually experience a whole lot of closures with COVID. A lot of the civil stuff would still be online even today, but a lot of the criminal stuff, because there's juries involved, there's like professional witnesses, etc., would still be in person. So there was a lot of restrictions around masks and social gatherings and numbers. Like a lot of the time, there'd be too many people in the courtroom, and we'd be kicked out. And the first people to be kicked out would be us, like the, because we're still considered like we're learning on the job type of things. We didn't really have any major roles, so that was frustrating. But I think it's coming around again, and I think everyone's really a lot more relaxed about COVID, which is a good thing. Hopefully, it stays like this.
Mm-hmm. Coming out the other side. Do you have any embarrassing moments?
Yeah, there was one time I was doing work for my master, which might sound like a bit medieval term, but it's the term they use at the bar. It's the person I'm working under for the year, and he told me, okay, so we have this guy, and he's accused of all these crimes, and he's gonna plead guilty, we think, okay, so that was fine. And in the meantime, which my master didn't tell me, was that the prosecution had ended a nolly, which basically means that they dropped the charges against the prison. So the judge called it, and my master wasn't here. So to get a delay, I said, oh, George, if you could put that to the end of the list, because when it's called again, we'll be ready, and this guy will plead, the client will plead. And then at that moment, everyone in court looked at me, including the client, to his eyes. And really, senior barrister on the other side, the prosecution side, correcting me, said, no, judge, sorry, that's not correct, the charges have been dropped, you know? So that spared me blushes. So then we came out then, I had to tell the client that you better thank the other barrister, because if it wasn't for him, I would have been setting you down, you know. He would have been doing time. So that was probably the most embarrassing thing.
Great know? Start as a barrister.
Yeah, great start. Sending innocent people to jail. Your own clients.
Is it stressful?
It can be stressful, but there's like a couple of hours a day which is stressful. Between 10 and 12, it's when it's all go. But then it's fine after, you know. And you're getting used to it, you know. Each day is learning day, you know. You learn better to leave things behind. So when you have an embarrassing moment like that, I think it's really important to drop it. Because if you carry it into the next day you're in court, you're more likely to mess up. And so yeah, I'm learning better to drop things and leave things behind.
It's probably an important skill for all of us, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
Don't carry embarrassing moments with you.
Yeah.
Who's been really influential on you through this journey into becoming a barrister?
Influential? I think anyone who's really helped me a lot. I already named Arnold O'Connor, who helped me a lot. He was the Pathways Law Coordinator. He kept in contact with me. I remember I met him when I was in fifth class, you know, and I still keep in contact with him today. He would have told me about all the great things Pathways Law was doing while I was still in Trinity. He would have pointed me towards Denham Fellowship. So he really, really was very helpful for me. Very grateful for that, you know. And starting as the bar, my master has been very good to me as well. You know, he's an extremely nice person who was pointing me in the right direction in many things. Anyone involved in the Susan Denham Fellowship, particularly Susan Denham herself, you know, she's been very helpful to me. There's a long list of people who've been helpful and inspiring to me, which I should be able to name a lot more, but they're probably going to have to be angry with me afterwards, you know.
You've touched on the last of them.
Also, my guidance counsellor from secondary school, you know, really, I wouldn't be here without her, you know. She was really sound, really, really sound. Wanted the best for all of us. Tried to get all of us to what we wanted, you know, so shout out to Miss Kinsler.
If you could go back and talk to your 12-year-old self, who was dreaming of being a footballer, with the notion of wanting to go to college as well, all these dreams, what advice would you give 12-year-old Mark?
Jeez, well, I think even at 12, I copped on it wasn't going to happen in terms of football. Advice to 12-year-old would be just enjoy the moment, really. Don't think about things that aren't in your control. Don't think about what job will I get when I go to college, because at the end of the day, I'm sure you've experienced it yourself. People come into college looking to do one thing, determined to do one thing, and then they, after a week, they change their minds. You know, people come in wanting to be doctors, and they leave historians, you know. And I think that would be my advice to you. I don't think about it too much. My favourite saying is, we cross that bridge when we come to it, you know. And you don't make too many plans, because plans change.
So if I asked you what your plans for the future were?
Plans for the future would be to make a decent, not, to make a living from being a barrister. Something I can live off and be happy, you know, very simple.
Mm-hmm. And do you think that's the philosophy that's helped to drive you forward? Like, I know you've talked about luck and missing loads of opportunities, but what is inside you that's enabled you to keep pushing and grabbing opportunities?
I think the persistence, you know, keep going with something. It can be difficult sometimes, you know, when you have setbacks and stuff. But I can keep going. Keeping busy is important, you know. Always trying to figure out areas of something productive. Even if you don't think it's productive, even something you like, you know. Keeping productive, persistent is something that keeps me going, you know. There's an end goal somewhere, you know. I think the problem when you don't have an end goal, maybe you need to reassess, you know. But being happy, you know, I think it's something we overlook so many times, you know. Always happy. I knew I'd be happy as a barrister, or I wouldn't have been happy if I didn't try to be a barrister, you know? If I took a safe option, or if I wanted to do a job with more security, I'd always would have had that thinking in the back of my mind, yeah, but I'd be a great barrister, you know? Like, I don't like this, but I'd be a great barrister, you know? I should have, would have, could have, you know? So that'd be my advice, people. Have no should have, would have, could have in your life.
It's been lovely talking to you, Mark, and catching up. I know there's lots of questions, I'm sure, coming from the audience, so thank you so much.
Thank you.
Congratulations on everything you've achieved, and I look forward to seeing what you achieve in the years to come. And I'm going to pass over to Dorothy now, who has some questions.
What this has done for you in terms of ambition and self-belief, especially now that you have qualified and you can see the difference from when you left school, what you're capable of doing.
Yeah, I think that's a good question. Barristers have big egos, and thing is about egos is we use the word ego a lot in a negative sense. But having a big ego or having any ego can be very positive outcomes, and that's self-confidence, you know. I think once people get qualified as a barrister, once they start to do decent work as a barrister, they believe they can do anything, you know. And I'm starting to get that myself, you know. Starting to be able to think there's very little things I can't do, you know, because I'm a barrister, you know, and other people are barristers, and they've done amazing things. So self-belief is growing at the moment a lot. And I think that comes with achieving goals. My main goal was to become a barrister. Maybe I'm still setting a new goal at the moment. You know, my new goal is able to make a living off it and be happy. But I think setting goals that are achievable and achieving them can do a lot for self-belief. I think barristers are very good at self-belief, or good at faking it. It's half the battle, you know.
Do you think the definition of happy will change, get broader, as you get more self-belief, more ambitious?
Maybe, you know, I think happiness is different. I'm probably very artificial. For me, achieving goals can be a lot for happiness, you know. Which is probably, I'm going to have a problem now next couple of years when I start to be happy as a barrister and I need to find a new goal, you know. And for me, happiness is, you know, setting goals and walking towards those goals.
Thank you.
which can make setbacks difficult, but once you're on the right track, you know.
Do you find it difficult
dealing
with your conscience sometimes, like when it comes to
like
certain cases?
Not really. Only because like I'm a bit of a law nerd, and I've read a lot about how the system can mess up, you know?
Yeah.
I think like criminal law is like such a unique system in the sense of you have the state stacking all the cards and all the resources available to the government in their attempt to prosecute somebody for something, you know? And there is a clear power imbalance in that, you know? Somebody has very little, individual has very little resources, the state has almost unlimited resources. So I don't have a clear conscience because I believe in the system. Even if I don't believe the system entirely works, I believe the system at least tries to keep the state honest, you know? And I'm a great man for the underdog story. So that always helps my conscience, you know. I love a David versus Goliath kind of type of thing, which is always good. But to be completely honest with you, I never really had a kind of conscious conflict so far, you know. I'm new into it,
yeah.
And I don't know how I'll do, but I'll let you know when I'm back.
This is a question that's come in online, and it's asked, what's the most challenging thing about being a barrister in terms of the type of cases that you're dealing with? And they also ask, how do you think your educational journey has equipped you for that?
Yeah, I think it's something probably underrated as a barrister, and I'm not taking many of my own cases at the moment, like I said, I'm still quite new to it, is learning how to treat people, and work with people, and understand people, you know? Coming from my own background and studying in Trinity, you know, you're meeting people from all walks of life. You know, meeting people from different countries, different needs, different wants, different inspirations. And at the end of the day, when you're working as a barrister, the main result is the client, you know, whether you're working in civil law or crime law, the main result is getting the best result from the client and being able to understand what a best result means for them. And understanding that all clients are different and different concerns or different needs, you know. Some clients may not care much about the outcome, care about a specific part of the outcome and how that will affect our future. Or some clients, perhaps maybe in a different area of law, are worried about other things like their kids or how a particular family law decision will affect their spouses or whatever. So I think understanding people's different needs and wants and being sympathetic and being able to communicate with people clearly, something which I think is probably underappreciated as a barrister. The customer is always right.
Was it hard for you to find your bearing when you first started your degree, and was there anything that you used to better support you in throughout your degree when you started?
Starting my degree, yeah, something called imposter syndrome, which I actually don't think I've ever had. Well, a lot of people talk about it, you know, I feel like I shouldn't really be here, I don't deserve to be here. And I think, for me anyway, I never really had that problem, only because I sat in a room full of people who got those 7 million points in their leaving cert. And some of them were idiots, you know? Some of them were very talented people, some of them were idiots though. But they had 7 million points on leaving cert. And for me, that was really self-assuring to realise that the system is broken, it doesn't really matter. You know, and that really avoided any imposter syndrome, you know. And, yeah, maybe it's not best to always compare yourself to others, though, but everyone's different. But, sorry, the second half of your question was the support, was it?
Yeah, was there any resources that you used to help support you throughout your grade? Like, if you felt like you were lacking in some area, was there anyone you could reach out to?
Yeah, I'm really bad at writing. Typing, like essays or whatever, I'm really bad, you know. Probably how I answer a lot of these questions, I kind of just say whatever words come into my head. And very not easy to put them into like a formative sentences, which more or less is kind of important for a barrister. And but I kind of struggle with that, and I always have struggled with that. And I use once or twice the Writing Resource Centre in Trinity. These are people who, like, even if you knew nothing about law, they knew what was good writing, you know, and what was more importantly what was bad writing, which I gave them plenty of examples of, you know. So that was a resource I always used. One thing other people struggled with, I didn't have so much in my degree, was mathematics. Even people studying maybe some social studies, if they had some modules in statistics, they often struggle. I'd always would have told them to use the maths help around, you know. Now maybe it does not help for every individual problem, but I would always encourage people, like I said, to use whatever you can get available to you, you know. Hopefully that answers your question.
Yeah.
That was a very inspiring piece, and I'm sure there's a lot more than look behind it. But I just wondered, has your accent ever been an issue? I mean, people have a perception of a Trinity College accent or a barrister's accent. Have you ever come up against anything where you haven't been quite as proud of your lovely Dublin accent?
Yeah, that's actually a great question. I'd always talk about this. I'd like to know what other people's opinion. It's, I don't know, a city in the world. So many different accents, you know, Dublin City, you know, you can more or less divide it north, south, or east, west, or class, or whatever. I don't know a city which, I kind of know countries have different accents, but I don't know a city with so many different accents. In Trinity, I think working class accent stands out, you know, and it goes back to what I was saying earlier, working class people always find each other, and it's easier on the accents, you know. I never felt conscious about it, I never felt it hindered me in any way, except for one time, and really, really one time, this memory stays very vivid in my mind. We were doing an online workshop in King's Inns, which is like the school for barristers, and I had COVID. It was back in January 2020. I had COVID, but I was fine, so I was still going to class. It was online, and I was doing some bit of speaking for some workshop, and the teacher, her feedback was, I mean, okay, you can do this better, all like acceptable points. The last bit of feedback was, you have an accent, so be conscious of that. Now, I didn't, maybe she understood it, you have an accent, speak slower, clearly, but I didn't take it like that, and I don't think anyone else in the class took it like that, you know. And I didn't feel embarrassed at all. I thought like that she wasn't a very nice person. But as soon as she logged off the chat or the class, everyone else said the exact same thing, saying she's not a very nice person either, you know. And that probably gave me a bit of more self-belief that no one else really cares about the accent, you know. Now working as a barrister, a lot of people would say to me, said like, if you speak in court with your normal accent, it comes across a lot more genuine, you know, rather than people who apparently then will try to alter their accent when they're speaking in public, you know, and it comes across as disingenuine, you know. And it kind of goes back to earlier what I was saying about being able to relate with clients. I think speaking your normal accent can help you relate with clients, you know. I think people can realise that you're not trying to fake it, that you're being who you are. I think that will really only stand to you, you know. But it was a good question about the accents, because I've always spoke about accents, about how they can kind of make people feel like they're less than what they actually are, you know. Thanks for that.